They never did, never brought up.
We say praise the Lord this morning.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. It's a good place to be, isn't it?
Amen.
Amen. I love to be in God's house, amongst God's people. Amen. You could be out in the world amongst people and not feel a thing, except they don't like you. But you come into God's house, and we're family. And when the family gets together, we're going to have a good time. Amen.
Yes.
And I don't know about you, but I'm looking forward one day to hear the trump sound and go home and be with Jesus forever and ever.
Yes,
what a day that'll be.
Yes.
And if you have your Bible, just an opening passage of scripture, and we're going to go over into Romans, the 6th chapter, and we're going to go right here at the 18th verse. Amen. Say amen when you get it, if you will stand to your feet for the reading of God's word. Amen. Amen. That's Romans 6. And we'll start at the 18th verse. It says, being then made free from sin, ye became the servants of righteousness. I speak after the manner of men, because of the infirmity of your flesh. For as ye have yielded your members servants to uncleanliness and to iniquity unto iniquity, even so now yield your members servants to the righteousness unto holiness. For when ye were the servants of sin, ye were freed from righteousness. What fruit had ye then in those things whereof ye are now ashamed? For the end of those things is death. But now, being made free from sin, and become servants of God, ye have your fruit unto holiness, and the end of everlasting life. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. May the Lord add to the reading of God's word, and let us pray this morning. You may be seated. Our Heavenly Father, as we come to you this morning, Lord, another time we've gathered together, Lord, to worship you and to thank you, Lord, for everything that you've done in our lives, in our church, in our community, Lord, in our state, in our country. God, we thank you, Lord, Father God, for touching our homes today. Lord, we thank you, Father, for our brothers and our sisters that are gathered together in your name, sing praise unto you, to give you glory, to give you honor this morning, Lord. Now, Father, as we go into this service, Lord, we pray, Father, if there's one here today that doesn't know you in the true pardon of sin, that this would be the day that they'd make their way to an old-fashioned altar of prayer and give their life over unto you, I pray, Lord. Now, Father, we ask today that, Lord, you would bless every song, every testimony, Lord. Lord, Father God, and bless Pastor Hearns as he brings forth the morning message, Lord. Not only let us have hearing ears, but a doing heart also, Lord, that is willing to go out and do your work and do, Lord, what you would have for us to do. Now, Father, we dedicate this service to you, Lord. We invite the Holy Spirit in this morning. May he find free course. We thank you and praise you, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you.
Amen.
Thank you, Reverend Solis. If you all have this hymn book, if you don't know the words, page 267, I know it was the blood, is the name of the song.
I know it was the blood.
2. I'm going to start in verse 1, and I may read all 12, and I may stop before that. John chapter 2. The miracle at Cana. Amen. When you found it, amen. And the third day, there was a marriage in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. And both Jesus was called and his disciples to the marriage. And when they wanted wine, the mother of Jesus saith unto him, They have no wine. Jesus saith unto her, Woman, what have I to do with thee? Mine hour is not yet come. His mother saith unto the servants, whatsoever he saith unto you, do it. And there were set there 6 water pots of stone, after the manner of the purifying of the Jews, containing 2 or 3 firkins apiece. Jesus saith unto them, fill the water pots with water, and they filled them up to the brim. And he saith unto them, draw out now, and bear unto the governor of the feast, and they bear it. And when the ruler of the feast had tasted the water that was made wine, and knew not whence it was, but the servants which drew the water knew, the governor of the feast called the bridegroom, and said unto him, every man at the beginning doth set forth good wine, and when men have well drunk that which is worse, then that which is worse, but thou hast kept the good wine until now. This beginning of miracles did Jesus in Cana of Galilee, and manifested forth his glory, and his disciples believed on him. After this, he went down to Capernaum, he and his mother and his brother and his disciples, and they continued there not many days. The book of John, chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Sit there, and do you have something for me?
Sure. Yes.
All right.
Sure.
Thank you. This is the beginning of the Passion of our Lord Christ, and it's called Palm Sunday. Right, that's what they have designated it from a Christian perspective, but it is really the entrance of Jesus into Jerusalem, where he began his suffering that day, where they called him Hosanna, King of the Jews. And it was that day that they had a week of circumstances and situations to occur in one place and continue to finish his course in another place. You will see after reading today that today's celebration and Friday's celebration are by 2 different kinds of people. They're not the same crowd, and I think many people have said that. They're praising on Sunday and crucifying on Friday. But there are some grateful people in this week, and there are some ungrateful people. There are some people who love him and would give to him for him the clothes off their backs. If you read it, you will see that they took their clothes up, strawed them in the way along with the palm branches today. And then on Thursday, they beat him all night long. And Friday, they stripped him naked. And I think you see a picture of a cross with him having some clothes on, but he was stripped naked in order to bring more vividly and more aware to the person who looks at it how damning sin was and how disgraceful it was, because he had put on him this purple robe by Herod, which was a disgrace within itself, and to strip him of it and beat him until every place on him bled. Mm-hmm. Amen. Every place on him bled. You do know that there are 12 signs as it relates to the zodiac, the 12 signs. All of you have one, born under one, and it shares with us something about our relationship with creation and how the sun, moon, and the stars affect our lives. But there was not a place where he was not bleeding for any one of us who is alive. Every sign received it, his passion as well as his crucifixion.
Amen.
And when they beat him, thanks for the song, when they beat him, they beat him until they were satisfied, not according to Roman law. Each of those men beat him 39 stripes minus one. Two men beat him 78 times until blood streamed from his brow down to his toes. And then too, he was not nailed in his hand, but he was nailed in his wrist. He was nailed in his wrist. I think you've read that somewhere. I'm not telling you something new. Y'all may tell me something, I don't know. But he was nailed in his wrists and tied to the cross across his arms with sinews and with straps. And then they had a seat on the cross that created some agonizing pain because it was where he sat naked, and the protrusion of that seat caused excruciating rectal pain. And then they crossed his feet, and they nailed nails through his ankles to hold him up. And I guess we've heard it in his hands and in his feet, and for me, he died. But in spite of all of that, the main thing is that he died. He died in our stead, in our place. And word in John says propitiation. And then the other word in Paul's writing is expiation. There was the guilt he died for, and then there was the actual punishment that sin had wreaked on the human race, the guilt and the actual sin. And he did not run from it. Matter of fact, he embraced it. And I love to say, and I guess it's not really understood by many, but it became him to become us.
Amen.
That we might become him.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
He took our place. Amen. Took our punishment.
Right.
So that when it came our time to fit in glory, glorification will have finished its process so that we might abide with him. Amen. 1 John, I think 3:1-2 says, it does not yet appear what we shall be. But when he appears, we shall be like him. Amen. No more flesh and bone, but celestial deities ourselves, so that we will enjoy the glories of heaven, as Ellen G. White stated in her books, that it will be a lifetime there, an eternity of loving God and singing songs that even the angels never knew. So this is a great season. This is a great season.
Amen.
Amen. Great season. I would like to have two volunteers today two men, two women, male or female, mm-hmm. to help me demonstrate something next Sunday. Y'all can get together with yourselves to determine who will be the lambs. But I just need two people, and those two people who might designate themselves or others might designate for you, see me before we leave service this morning, kind of try to explain what we want to do. But this is one of the most glorious days in Christian worship.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. The other being the day that songwriter said, in the beauty of the lilies, Christ was born mm-hmm. across the sea with the glory in his bosom that transfigured you and me. And then it says something like, his truth is marching on.
Amen.
And this is a glorious week.
Amen.
Where we came from in Warren and Youngstown, we had a week of activities.
Mm-hmm.
Congregation participated in what happened that week and gave them a role to play as if they were there when it happened. Mm-hmm. And I think maybe it wasn't in this song, but there's a song that says, it asks the interrogative, were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there? Were you there? God bless you, Sister Erin. Amen.
Imagine yourself in the back of the days. There were some men working on a building there. And there were some lambs playing on the ground.
For me, who am I? took all my pain. Christ, he gave me sacrifice, he made.
They do seem from the entrance of the wise men into Jerusalem and inquired, where is he that is born King of the Jews? At 2 years of age at that time, it was stated that for this cause he came into the world. He was born of a woman, but not like a woman. He grew up as man, but he also grew up as the second man, or the second Adam, as you may know. The first Adam could not defend for himself, but Jesus, the second Adam, took on all of our, as the songwriter says, soul's diseases, and made us a pleasant sight for God our Father. He was born, and the wise men discovered him at 2. And then at 12, he demonstrated for us in the temple where the bishop, doctors, and lawyers were exceedingly privileged to have the knowledge to explain, so they said, what they knew God was about. And on their way to the temple worship, Jesus, on his way home, lingered behind and stopped off at the church. And there he was questioned by the rabbi and the scholars. And then he was questioning them about their knowledge of God, until they discovered that he knew more about God than they had learned from their books. He had such a grasp on eternal things that they could never experience, because they did not come from where he came. He came from glory. And they came from unglorified man. At 12, he was missing for 18 years. 18 years somewhere doing something, I know not what. Bible does not tell us where he was, nor what he was doing for 18 years. You do the math, 18 and 12 will get us to our text. But he was somewhere speculatively learning how to become a carpenter out of his daddy's carpenter shop. Or he was somewhere learning in the school of Shammai how to become a prophet. Speculated that those 18 years where he was preparing for this very moment just read, his father thought he was going to be a carpenter. But Jesus spoke to the Father above, and they had a change of plans. He was not going to be his stepfather's carpenter, but he was going to be his daddy's savior. 18 years.
Amen.
12 is 30. At 30.
Yes.
Here in the text, he was 30, where he began to perform his purpose, and I've talked about purpose, for his being in the world. He would only be here 33 and a half years. But in those 33 and a half years, he would perform for us something marvelously mysterious and wonderfully adventurous. He would perform for us something that we could not do for ourselves. He saw our hopelessness, he saw our helplessness, and he saw our fatigue in trying to measure up. And all of the while we were measuring up, we were always falling.
Amen.
The Bible does say that those who practice sin tried to measure up, but because of sin, would always come short of the glory of God. At this text, there are some words I wish you would jot down, write down, go to your personal library or some commentary or some dictionary. There's a word called Haggadah, H-A-G-G. A-D-A-H, Haggadah. need to associate that with this text. And there is a word in this text that is associated with a lamb, and that is, a lamb had to be killed during his ministry in order to satisfy all of the sin that had been permitted and by God and excused by the people. And he became that Paschal, P-A-S-C-A-L, Paschal lamb, that lamb the Jews selected that would take away the sin of the nation. It was in this text that he becomes that lamb. In another text, as he was striding down the shore of the river, it was John the Baptist who looked and saw him coming and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world." There are in the book of John 8 such miracles that helps us understand the purpose of God. If my memory fails me to give them all to you, ask Sister Hearns, she knows. Number one is the miracle of salvation. Number two is the miracle of faith. Number three is the miracle of grace. Number four is the miracle of satisfaction. Number five is the miracle of seeing God. Number six is the miracle of life-giving. Number seven is the miracle of our unification with him. And number eight is the demonstration of how much he loved us in comparison to how much we loved him. It was in this parable, in this miracle, that Jesus helps us to see how he can save. The text says that there were some marvelous things happening. And one of those marvelous things was that he tells his mother by using this phrase, "Woman, what have I to do with you?" That from that moment on, his mother would not direct his life anymore, but his life would be directed by his father.
Amen.
Not Joseph, but his father in glory.
Amen.
And his father would direct every aspect of his life from there on. And this particular pericope of scripture helps us to deal with how salvation works. And salvation is capsuled by what Mary says. Mary says, "Whatever he says, do, do it."
Amen.
Now, can I put an interrogative there? Whatever he says, do, will help us to understand that there is no other way to be saved.
Mm-hmm.
Other than hearing what Jesus has to say.
Mm-hmm.
Can anyone be saved without hearing the method to be saved?
Mm-hmm.
None can be saved unless they are saved the way Jesus provides.
Amen.
Does Jesus need any help to save us?
No, sir.
He does not need his mother to tell him how much sin is prevalent in the world.
Mm-hmm.
He came knowing how much sin there was. He came specifically to Galilee, knowing that there in Galilee was a mass as much heinous activity as one could expect as it relates to the order of men. Sin abounded in mm-hmm. Galilee.
Amen.
And so the best place for Jesus to work out our salvation is the place where sin most abounds. If sin is going to be the thing that causes our ruin, then he must be in the place co-operational with sin in order to destroy sin. And in destroying sin, he destroys the devil along with sin.
Mm-hmm.
And when he destroys the devil, the text says, when the prince of the power of the air is destroyed, then I will call you, or I will make you to become my disciple, or I will draw all men. I think that's a better interpretation. Mm-hmm. Draw all men
yes.
who want to be saved
uh-huh.
unto myself, mm-hmm. that where I am, there ye may be also.
Amen.
Salvation, according to Jesus, is that he needs no other person to help him to save. I like David, but Jesus only quotes David in his teachings once or twice during his lifetime. So he does not really need David to help him save. He only quotes Moses a few times, and that's because he's under the law of Moses. But he really doesn't need Moses
mm-hmm.
to help him save. Moses and Elijah met him on the Mount of Transfiguration, and they had a discussion about whether Jesus was going to go to Jerusalem and do this awful thing, and did he need any help? Moses and Elijah conferred among themselves and which one of us will help him. And just about that time, a voice came from heaven and said, this is
mm-hmm.
my beloved son.
Mm-hmm.
Hear ye him
mm-hmm.
only.
Yes.
But he doesn't need any help.
No, sir. Amen.
Can I get away?
Amen.
He knows better what to pull us up out of than we know what we're in.
Amen.
Can I get a witness?
Amen.
Amen.
He knows better what's making us fall
mm-hmm.
so often and so repeatedly that we don't need to tell him what's making us fall, because every time we try to get up, we fall again, and he knows it, because he goes all the way back to Adam, that when Adam tried to rise, Adam kept on falling. So to be saved, one must be kept from falling. And the thing that makes men fall is what Adam fell to.
Mm-hmm.
And that was sin.
Amen.
Failing to measure up to the recommendations or the expectation of God. God had made Adam out of himself and mm-hmm. blew into his nostrils the breath of life that made him holy.
Mm-hmm.
But when Adam could not function holy, he fell into the sinister trap of Satan. And from there on, there was the plan set to save mankind. And Jesus, way back in eternity, had already been designated as, number one, the Lamb
mm-hmm.
that would take away the sin of the world. And that he would come from the tribe of Judah, because while they were under the altar, the lamb and the lion were talking together. Lamb said, I'll shed blood. And the lion said, I'll come from the tribe of Judah.
Mm-hmm.
And so Jesus had already been predicted to be the one to save humanity. I struggle, Gary. I struggled so hard to understand God. I don't know about you, but I struggled so hard to understand God. Sister Hearns asked me this morning, somewhere around 5 o'clock, what you doing? I said, well, I've been awake all night. And I said, she said, that ain't what I asked her. She said, what you doing? What you doing? Not that I was awake all night, but I was awake most of the night listening to God.
Mm-hmm.
Can I get awake?
Yeah.
And the only way to talk about God is to do what Mary said do, is to
mm-hmm. what he said.
Do whatever
he said do.
And you have to spend some time listening
Amen.
To the prerequisite of God. God wants to say something. And he wants to say something not to the church, because the church is his. He wants to say something to people who are out there in the world.
Yes.
Who are not hearing anything
mm-hmm.
but that which tickles their fancy. And that which causes them to rise and fall
mm-hmm.
and never measure up to the expectation of God.
Amen.
Yes.
You have to listen to God.
Amen.
And Mary says to these servants, who are servants of sin, whatever he tells you to do, whatever he, the words are uniquely his.
Mm-hmm.
Can I get a witness? He didn't copy them from some other scholar. They are uniquely his, Sabbath. The words are his, rightly so, even though Isaiah said that he would be some of what he practiced. Mm-hmm. But the words are uniquely Jesus.
Amen.
He came as Savior. He came as a Joshua.
Mm-hmm.
He came as one who would get us out of what we were in and put us somewhere where we could rise to another level of his glory.
Amen.
Can I get a witness? Even though Isaiah talks about him being the priestly prophet, even though Isaiah talks about him being wonderful and counselor, he does not depend upon Isaiah to help him save.
Amen.
Jesus saves all by himself.
Amen.
And if there's anyone who needs saving, it is those who have lost all of their hope.
Amen.
Lost their hope in humanity. Lost their hope in God. lost their hope of ever being able to get out of the mess that they're mired in. And Jesus says, I have come that you might have life. And Mary says, whatever he said, do it. And that's the secret to salvation. It's a mystery. What part of me is saved first? You do know that we are a trichotomy of person. Trichotomy means that we are a three-part person. Trichotomy, body, what you see, soul, and spirit. What gets saved first? Glad you asked. The part that causes us to get us in the most trouble. Can I get a witness?
Amen.
The part that causes us to keep on falling when we want to get up. The part that causes us to fall when we want to run.
Yeah.
The part. There's a part in us that you don't see, but it causes the rest of us to act crazy. Mm-hmm. The soul and the spirit have agreed because of their rebellion against God. We're going to take our rebellion against God out on man, and we're going to treat man, the prize and the glory of God, as if he is nothing but a scoundrel. Satan had done everything he could to impress upon the mind and the imagination of man that you are nothing and never will be. So man learns to live beneath his dignity. Man had been told by Satan that God used you as a test tube baby to see if you will ever survive in this society. Mm-hmm. And he says, God never wanted you to be his sons. He wanted you to fail. Soul and the spirit had been so jeopardized by sin and Satan that all they could do was think about how they could make this man fail and fall. Had done a pretty good job, too. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Amen. Because everything in the world then was either sinister, perpetrated by sinners, and the end result was that all had sinned and come short. Mm-hmm. But I thank God for Mary. She said, if servants of sin want to be released from the power of sin, you need to hear Jesus. Can I get a witness? And I'm not really talking to us this morning, but I'm talking to what we used to be.
Amen.
In order to be released from what we used to be, our spirit and our soul has to listen to God.
Amen.
Many of us are listening to the educators, but the educators can't even save themselves. They become educated, but what really happens to them, they become educated fools.
Amen.
You try to get people to rise above all of the stigma and the stamina that goes on in our community, but when some people get up, they never realize that somebody was helping them get up and out.
Amen.
And they never look back to see who it was. They just keep on going. But if we get up, if we get out, our responsibility is to look back to see who helped us get up.
Yes.
And then lend a helping hand.
Amen.
To help somebody else get up.
Amen.
And help somebody else get out. But Jesus doesn't need any help because Satan had crippled the mind. He had crippled the soul and the spirit. Well, they had agreed that we're going to keep man in this stigma. But Jesus did not work on our bodies. Hello?
Amen.
Whatever he says, do it silently.
Yeah.
Do you see them taking that water? Nobody else knew it was water.
Mm-hmm.
But the service. Mm-hmm. But the water was going to do something to help us understand that a change must take place.
Amen.
If you're going to get saved, if you're going to be a child of God, if you're going to be the light of the world, you've got to be saved. I don't mind you arguing with me later, but in order to be saved, you got to hear what can save you.
Amen.
Philosophy can't do it.
Amen.
Amen. Education can't do it.
Amen.
Being in the right crowd of social lights can't do it.
Amen.
You've got to hear the word from the Lord.
Amen.
And I'm going to say something right here that's going to strike you. But it's not the word of God that will save you, but it's the word of Jesus.
Amen.
Jesus comes here as God.
Amen.
To help us to get back in good grace with God.
Amen.
And the only way he could do it was die for us.
Oh, man.
So that God could embrace us again. So I thank God for Jesus.
Yeah.
He gives me the words to understand as to how I ought to believe. And how should I believe? Believe the word of Jesus. And Jesus tell Nicodemus, you must be.
Yeah.
Amen.
You know what he told Nicodemus, don't you? You must be born again. Nicodemus didn't understand it. He was talking about soul and spirit. The soul must be born from above. The spirit needs to be born from God. And the body eventually must die or come into conformity. I thank God that I'm not yet dead, but I'm living according to the rules and the regulations of God.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Mighty good preacher.
Somebody told me, he said, Frank, you walk like Philanders. Somebody else said, you kind of resemble Philanders. And then another family member said, you are from Philanders' father, Thomas. And didn't really know what they were saying until I got older.
Mm-hmm.
What they were saying was that I resembled my earthly parentage.
Yeah.
Like y'all ought to see them.
Come on now.
And when I got saved,
yes,
I didn't resemble my earthly parentage anymore. Even though you may not be able to see it, I began to resemble my Heavenly Father's family.
Come on.
I started acting like him,
uh-huh.
Acting holy and sanctified and filled with the Holy. I started acting like that.
Yes.
And other folk would say, well, he think he's somebody.
Yeah.
I thought I was somebody.
Come on, man.
When you get saved, things begin to happen to you that's never happened to you before. So what you do is you start acting like you feel.
Yeah.
Can
I get away? I felt like coming to justice, folks. So I did. I felt like raising my hand. So I did. I felt like enjoying Aaron. So I got over here so I could see what she was doing clearly. And I enjoyed her.
Amen.
When I come here, I'm going to try to act like my dad.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah. And did you not know? Whenever you do what he said do, you can't go wrong.
That's
right. With you. If he says shout, shout.
Yeah.
If he says cry, cry. If
yeah.
he says run, run. If he says wave your hand, wave your hand. But you ought to be able to show somebody through sign that you got God in your life. And Jesus is the image of God. Hallelujah. Whatever he said, do. Not what Abraham said.
That's right.
Not what Isaac said. Not what Jacob said. Not what Israel said. Not what Isaiah said. Not what Jeremiah said. Not what Michael said, but what Jesus. Jesus, he is the epitome of his Father.
Yeah.
He looks like, he acts like, he walks like, he talks
come on,
like.
Come on.
So I'm trying to act like my daddy.
Amen.
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 How many of you trying to act like it? Some folk won't let you be holy.
Amen.
Right.
Some folk press your legs.
Amen.
Some folk get on your last nerve.
Amen.
Some folk just wear you out.
For
talking about other folk.
Yeah,
y'all been there. Some folks just don't want you to be holy than others because others want you to be compared to them. But oh, my sisters and brothers, you've got to rise up another level in order to be what God. Not to be what other humans are, but you've got to keep on rising, keep on trying, keep on trying the best of your ability to be like your Father.
Amen.
That's right.
Amen.
Some things come to trip us up. Yes, I admit. I don't drink, but I don't drink no more than I've been drinking.
Yeah.
Amen.
You can get that out.
Amen.
I have the capacity to do it. Amen. But in order to live holy, you've got to participate in holy things.
Amen.
Did I say that correctly? In order to live holy, you have to participate in holy things. And God is, I do declare, is in the world. But on Sunday morning, he meets us here. Amen. And when he meets us here, we're supposed to have a meeting with him. And when we have this meeting with him, it's supposed to make us feel better.
Amen.
It's supposed to make us act better. We're not all that we're supposed to become, but little bit by little bit, we're becoming more like him every day.
Amen.
Because we are learning to hear what he says do.
Amen.
Oh, I thank God.
Amen.
I thank God for Jesus. I don't
Amen.
Know. I don't know if you ever thought about it, that if it wasn't for Jesus, this world would be so corrupt. This world would be topsy-turvy, turned upside down.
Amen.
But Jesus in the world makes a difference.
Amen.
He makes a difference. I don't cuss much.
Come on, man.
Come on now.
But it's in me.
Amen.
Yeah. Amen. Y'all have to say amen with me now.
Amen.
Amen.
It's in me.
Amen.
I don't run the street like I used to.
Amen.
But time has made it so that I can't run fast no more.
Yeah.
But the desire is always in me.
Amen.
Can I get a
amen?
Amen. 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 There are things that I used to do I can't do anymore, and I can't lay it all on holiness. Time takes away some of the stuff that we ought to have been doing.
Amen.
Time takes away some of it, but the most I want to give credit to, not just time, but I want to give credit to Jesus.
Amen.
If Jesus is not in our lives, we just go pumpkin foolish.
Yeah.
If Jesus is not in our life, we really don't know how to glorify God, because Jesus is the way to the glory of heaven.
Yeah.
And when we get glorified, when we get changed, when we get qualified, we don't have to worry about doing it here just on Sunday. When we get to glory, we're going to do it every day. We're going to do it all day long. Praise God. Whatever he says do, do it.
Yeah.
Whatever he said do, do it. And I love the Lord.
Bless the Lord.
Bless him.
He heard my cry.
Amen.
PD, my ever-grown, long as trouble ride, I'll hurry, I'll hasten to his throne.
Yes, sir.
For when I get to his throne, he has a way of helping me to balance my life as it relates to my trouble. all of us are going to have trouble in this life.
Amen.
And in this life, we are considered men most miserable. But we can chase the misery away by just reading a little more about what Jesus said. And if we read more about what he said, we can become more like him. I said last week, I don't mind dying, because dying just puts me into the other space, the other realm where I'll live forever. But you have to keep on trusting in the Lord.
Amen.
I will trust in the Lord until I die. And then another one said, I'm going to stay on the battlefield until I die.
Yes.
And then I heard somebody else say in another place, you can't make me doubting, because I just know too much about him.
Amen.
Now how do I know much about him? I kept on reading the red letter Bible.
Yes.
Can I get a witness?
Yes, bless the Lord.
And every Bible does not have red letters. But when you get a red letter Bible, it specifically tells you what Jesus said. But also in the Bible, it has a comparative word from the Pharisee, the Sadducee, and all of the priests and the hypocrites. But I'm not looking for what they said.
Yeah.
I'm looking for what Jesus said. Because it's because of him that I am what I am.
Amen.
I am a child of the King.
Amen.
And you can't make me, take it down and give over to somebody else saying it's because of your own good sense.
Yes.
I don't have sense enough right now in this part of my earthly life to tell the Lord, I don't need you. If I get to that point, surely I've gone crazy.
Amen.
But I need the Lord every day of
Amen. My
life.
Amen.
I need him when I wake up.
Amen.
And because I wake up, I just said, thank you, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
I need him this morning, because at the breakfast table, Sister Hearns, she sometimes think that I should say, thank you for this food and amen. But I take a little bit more time to thank God for her. Can I get a witness? I thank God for where she came from, the spirits of her mama and her daddy. And I even thank God for my children. At the breakfast table, before I take one bite of food, I give thanks to God. Because if it had not been for the Lord bringing me this far, I really wouldn't be here today. I'd be dead and somewhere in my grave. But the Lord has made a way for me, and I surely know that he's made a way for you. If there's anybody here who can say with a raised hand, the Lord has made a way, and I just can't help but tell somebody, I thank God this morning just for being in church. I thank God this morning just for being saved. I ain't what I ought to be, but I thank God I'm not what I used to be. I keep on striving because I keep on hearing the word in my ear. The word the Lord said, I will make a way out of no way. Is there anybody here today who can say, I'm here by the grace of God? God picked you up when you wasn't nothing. God picked you up when you wasn't going nowhere. God picked you up when you didn't have nothing to say. But God gave you His image, and He gave you His likeness. So everywhere you go, you ought to let your light shine. Am I got a witness this morning? Everything you said today, you ought to say in reference to the goodness of the Lord. If it had not been for the Lord on my side, I don't know where I would be today. So I just thank the Lord, not only for where I am, I thank the Lord from where He brought me from. I thank the Lord for how He had raised me and never ever let me down. Ain't God all right? Somebody up in here today ought to give Him some undivided attention. Somebody here today ought to give Him some praise. He's worthy. Praise. He's worthy of somebody just waving their hand. Ain't God all right? I came to Him as I was. I was weary, wounded, and sad, but I found in Him a resting place, and He made me glad. I'm glad. Amen. I'm saved. I'm glad today that I'm a child of God. I'm glad that I'm a part of the Christian family. I'm glad today. Ain't God all right? Say yeah today. Oh, yeah.
Bless the Lord.
The mystery of salvation.
Amen.
Amen.
I really don't know how I got saved. All I know is that Jesus did.
Yes.
And I believe.
Amen.
Believe what He said, believe what He did, and believe Him forevermore. Satisfied.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody help me sing that song. Can you help me? Satisfied with Jesus.
I'm satisfied with Jesus.
I'm satisfied with Jesus.
You can't make me down.
Sometimes we say, if God has blessed you. That's a lie. God has blessed.
Yeah, he's blessed.
Amen.
So we show our appreciation not in money, but by doing what he says, go ye therefore. Amen?
Amen.
But he also has taught us to give to support the church, to support his ministry. Hence why we tithe and give offering. Amen?
Amen.
So as we have your tithes and offering, if you have a heart to give, please come around. My left hand is the basket for tithes and offering. My right hand is for the benevolence offering. And if I could ask Sister Prater, can you please bring me an envelope? Please come. Thank you, Father, for your blessings that we may have been able to give. And we just ask you, Lord, to continue to watch over us. Lead us and guide us in the way that you would have us to go, Father, that we may live according to your word, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We have our announcements.
Keep us informed where there's going to be some hour where we can come and pay our respects.
That's already.
And make certain and ensure that the Christian community feels for those who have lost someone
Amen.
Dear to them.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. There's a day in next week, and it's Thursday. And it's called Monday Thursday. And add it to the words I gave you, and it's spelled M-A-U-N-D-Y. Monday Thursday. It's critical to our knowledge of what they did to Jesus and what we ought to do in remembrance of what he has done for us. M-A-U-N-D-Y. It's been pronounced erroneously Monday Thursday.
Oh, that's right.
But it's Monday, M-A-U-N-D-Y. Monday
Thursday.
Thursday. And then there is Good Friday.
Mm-hmm.
That's where the Paschal Lamb is crucified. And then there's a word about the Paschal Lamb, the Pesach. P-E-S-A-C. P-E-S-A-C, Pesach. The fish not spelled that way either. So what happened?
No, I can't hear you.
P-E-S-A-C, Pesach. And that's the choice piece of meat in the Haggadah. And wine in the Haggadah had a cup at the end of the table. And it was called the cup of Elijah. The cup of Elijah. And the cup of Elijah is not just a wine cup filled with wine. It's to represent a person who is to come and announce the coming of Jesus Christ or the Savior. At that time, they were looking for Elijah. At this time, when they have Monday, Thursday, and Good Friday, they're looking for the Savior who is to be announced. And we do have that fulfillment in John announcing as Elijah, Jesus, who is the Savior of the world. Amen.
Amen.
All right, y'all ready to go home?
Amen.
Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Let the church say amen. God has spoken.
So
let the church say amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you for our gathering. Thank you for our worship. We thank you for our community of praise. And when we leave here, let us remember where we've been and mostly whom we've had this meeting with. And when we go through the rest of the week, remembering that it is not us, but it is to him whom we give praise.
Amen.
We thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
And amen.
Amen. Amen.